We have today here a Guy Walker from Buckinghamshire University, UK, to talk about the gaming industry in UK and Europe perhaps, and also how technology and creativity come together in a unique industry such as gaming.
Yes, within the UK, the games industry is quite a large one. I think we're the third or fourth largest developer of games within the world.
Okay.
There tend to be sort of three aspects with the in-games industry. So there'll be the designers who come up with the ideas of the games and the gameplay, the rules, the game.
Yeah? The creative side of it.
Yeah, the creative side, but more from a sociological and psychological aspect of how to play the game, what makes the game fun, okay, what makes it interesting, how quickly they can learn, the learning systems involved with it. So there's that side, there's the artistic side, with the animators, the programmers, the concept artists, even down to a level of creating textures, audio, perhaps even video clips. And then there's the programming side. That's the side I'm interested in, is the game's developers. I think the programming is rather like the glue that glues the assets, the artwork, into the storyline to actually give the game. So it's a very interesting area.
You were talking about the people who study the gaming industry, the tool, having job opportunities in many other industries as well, such as about
coder programming. Yes, I mean the programming that students learn for games is very similar to that used within business. So there's a lot of transferable skills that they can apply. The games industry in the UK, and I think everywhere in the world, is very competitive, very difficult to get into your foot through the door. Okay, and what tends to happen is that you have to establish yourself as a specialist in that field, but maybe within a different sector. Build up this experience, build up a portfolio work, and then apply for the jobs within the games industry.
Right, so I think that the key word here is the specialization, or to become a specialist.
Yes and no. It's a complicated situation because if you wanted to work with a big studio and they've got 200 people working on a game, then they employ specialists. But there's been a move away from the big studios in the last 5 years.
Right.
If you look at the revenue generated by console games, it's halved in the last 4 or 5 years.
Right.
Yeah, there's a hole. The games industry is generating more income. And this increase is being fed by the indie games developers. And they're a completely different animal to your specialist team player within a large studio. So they've got a cross-section of skills, maybe a specialist in one area, but they're used to working in small teams, maybe 3 or 4 people.
Okay.
So they have to have a much wider knowledge.
I guess it's more into the exposure to the tool chain.
Yes. So you wouldn't have a specialist who can only create character models.
Okay.
You create any type of models, he'd be able to animate them.
Okay.
He'll have some input into the story, the design of the game as well.
Okay.
So he may not be a coder, but there may be another team member of his small group of three, is a coder. But even that coder will have some input into the design and maybe know something about Maya or Max for modeling.
Now, how is it that the mobile gaming industry, mobile phones and the tablets and things like the devices, other than the PC, making an inroad into the gaming there? What kind of tools they use?
It's the same tools. I mean, we use at the university Unity, and you create a game within Unity, maybe for the PC.
Right.
You press a button, and you select Android, put it down to Android. Select PS3, PS4, literally at the click of a button, you can port it down to different platforms. That's if you've got the licenses, though. So PS4 licenses, difficult to get. Xbox One license, difficult to get. But the other platforms, yes. So it's simple as that.
So what you're saying is that the technology has evolved and developed so that you don't need to be specific to a platform.
No.
But then if you're sort of exposed to all that and you can get a general idea about what's going on, and then specific related to platform, then you can still make a...
I think the idea is that eventually you want to make money out of it, whether you're a studio or an indie. So the more platforms you cover, the better. Okay, so you've got to think about your audience. Okay, don't marginalize yourself to one platform. Keep yourself widespread open. Okay, but use this philosophy, develop once, deploy everything.
Like Java, I guess.
Like Java.
Like once, run anywhere.
But it's so easy now. I mean, your students could set themselves up as indie developers. The tools are free, most of them. Unity's free.
Okay.
They don't have to worry about going to a publisher who will print their CDs off or DVDs off.
Right.
They don't need to worry about distribution.
Yeah.
They can do this through these online sources.
Okay.
Whereas Apple Play, or maybe they want to go onto Steam.
Right.
All the marketing's done for you. They take a percentage, but you reach a big audience.
Right.
So the volume will generate
money. Excellent.
I would just say that the courses you're learning here, certainly the interactive media courses, okay, there's a lot of information you're learning there, a lot of techniques and tools you're learning, okay, that can be exploited within the games industry. But what's key is producing a portfolio of work. Okay? It's the portfolio of work that's going to get you the job. Okay? So be creative, be original within your portfolio, okay, and never give up. Just keep plugging away. It's always difficult to get your dream job, okay, but those who persevere usually do. So I wish you luck.
Thank you very much, Guy, for enlightening our students here today about the gaming industry.
Okay.
Good day.